With us. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm chapter 5, starting in verse 3. In the morning, Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my request before you and wait expectantly. For you are not a God who is pleased with wickedness. With you, evil people are not welcome. The arrogant cannot stand in your presence. You hate all who do wrong. You destroy those who tell lies. The bloodthirsty and deceitful you, Lord, detest. But I, by your great love, can come into your house. In reverence, I bow down toward your holy temple. Lead me, Lord, in your righteousness because of my enemies. Make your way straight before me. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we come into your house this morning to honor you, to bow our hearts in reverence before you. We lift our voices in prayer, and we wait expectantly, for we know that you can and you will do mighty things. For you are the one true God, the creator of the universe. There is nothing that exists that does not fall under your dominion, and we are humbled in your presence. We ask that you would lead us in your righteousness. Make straight the way that we should go, for you are the way maker, the miracle worker, the promise keeper, the light in the darkness. We worship your holy name, Father. We give our hearts to you this morning and ask that you would remove any distractions, any thoughts, any burdens that are weighing us down, that we might worship you in spirit and in truth. Let your Holy Spirit move among us this morning. Bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Let us love one another as we love you, Lord. Write your holy word on our hearts today, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please stand now as we sing together, Waymaker.
I worship you. it is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. 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 Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you
should come, then this place.
Lord God, my sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh, my soul. Lord, we love you. We bless you this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Amen.
Thank you, friends. My sin, not in part, but the whole. Oh, he doesn't pay half the bill, and we're left to give the tip, right? Doesn't bring the ball to the 10-yard line, and we got to bring it over the rest. Our sin not, and our faith shall be sight. Oh, the bliss of this. What a great song that we get to praise our Savior Jesus with. I hope that you're thrilled this morning about this news. What glorious news. It's so good to be with you this morning at Emmanuel Baptist Church. If you're new, I want to thank you so much for being our guest. We hope that you can fill out a connection card. It should be in front of you in the pew. You can fill that out. You can drop it in our offering box at the back of the service. You can give it to one of the greeters. We would just love to pray for you and get to know you better and pray for you and your family. I hope that you can do that. My name's Kyle, by the way. I'm one of the pastors here at Emmanuel Baptist Church. Specifically, I'm tasked with working with the worship team and music and also youth. Our teaching pastor is away, obviously today, and last week he was away. He's celebrating the wedding of his daughter. I think, where are they? In Michigan or Minnesota? Where is it? Virginia? Oh, okay. He's somewhere. He's not here. We know this. But just pray for him. He's going to be here next week preaching. That's going to be a lot of fun to have him back. We miss him, of course. But I hope that you enjoy today's service. By way of announcement, we have a few. And some of these are going to be on the screen, too. So if you want to take pictures of the slides to help you remind yourself of some of the things. That's the world we live in today, right? You can just whip out a phone and snap a picture if you want to remind yourself or make a note and jot it down. But some of the things that we have going on, VBS is coming up. That's a lot of fun, and there's a lot of work happening going around that. But if you're a volunteer, there's going to be an orientation on July 21st, which I think is Thursday. Thursday, July 21st, and that's from 7 to 9:30 p.m. And this nice lady over here, wave her hand for us so that if you are volunteering and you're confused, you go see her and she'll straighten you out, okay? That's going to be a lot of fun. And they actually still need some volunteers. VBS is July 25th through the 29th. So if you can volunteer, it's down to the last wire, just go see them. Also, please register your children if you haven't already. You can go to EBC, so Emmanuel Baptist Church, ebcnorfolk.org, and you can look up more information about VBS. Also, the food pantry is looking for some more volunteers, so you can see Dee or Peg. Can you raise your hands, Dee or Peg? Nice and high. You can see those hands after church. All hands look the same, but maybe you can find their face. Go see them, and they can help you out with that. Finally, we're having an exciting event to just sort of kick off the youth ministry for the fall. We're having some events in the summer. Of course, I was brought here to serve the youth and families and also lead worship in the form of music. But one of the things that we're doing over the summer is to have some events to get to know each other and build relationships and just have some fun. So on July 30th, from 2 to 6, we're going to be at the Ricketts House. They have a nice in-ground pool. The first day I saw it and visited them, I was like, we're having events here. You have a big pool. So that's your job, right? And they were more than willing to do that. So snap a picture of that. It's for ages 12 and up, but mom and dad can come. If you have other siblings and they're little, bring them too. We're going to have a lot of fun, okay? So again, snap a picture of that. And let me know if you can come. You'll see my email address on the slide before that. Can you just go back to that slide? Yeah, so that's my email address. If you want to come, PastorKyle@ebcnorfolk.org. To let me know if you're coming or not so we can buy enough pizza, right? All right. Lastly, one way that we worship Jesus as a local church is through our generous, regular, and joyful giving. So at your leisure, if you can drop, if you have a contribution, you can drop it in that offering box when you get a chance in the rear of the chapel, or you can just go to our website and you can give online. There's a way to do that. So, okay, would you join me in prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning just so thrilled that you have dealt with our sin, not in part, not halfway, but all of it. It is finished. He has done it. Let the weary heart rejoice. God, we pray for Bill and Sue Lagos, who lost their mother. Would you be with them as they grieve? Touch their hearts, their family and siblings and others that love this dear woman. God, we pray, Lord, that you would bless this church, that you would give us faith, that you would bless the things going on in the coming weeks, such as VBS and the prayer and pie, which I think I forgot to announce. I apologize. That's coming up as well, too. But God, bless prayer and pie. Help the church to gather on this important day, this Friday, to pray for VBS, to pray for each other. As we celebrate and sing and even eat some sweets, I pray, Lord, that your church would gather. I pray, Lord, for the youth of this church, that we would come out and get to know each other, that we would have Christ formed in us. Bless Pastor Pete, Lord, as he's celebrating his daughter and her new husband. Give them rest and strength, rejuvenate their faith. And God, we want to pray for the local church, not just this one, but others. I think of Waters Church, that's in Attleboro, and the different ministries and efforts that they're making. Be with their pastors and leaders and people. Make them holy. Form them into your image. Bless Tim, Pastor Tim. Give him strength. God, I pray, Lord, that you would bless the sermon as we hear it, God, that we sing the word that Brother Mark led, but we also pray the word and we hear the word preached and read. God, give us ears to hear, and let those who don't know Christ yet see the light of life in our blessed Redeemer and Lord. Bless these words now. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, would you stand with me for the reading of our text? You can grab a pew Bible if you don't have one with you. It's always great to bring your own Bible to church because sometimes you can see notes you've made and passages and reflect on different things that you've learned over the years, even jot some in them and take them home for something that stuck out to you in the sermon. So if you would open your Bible to Luke chapter 9, verses 57 through 62. If you don't have a Bible, we'd love to give you one, so you can just come see me after church. Or if you don't have a Bible right now, the words are going to be on the screen, so you can follow along up there. It says this, Jesus said, to his disciples, as they were walking along the road, a man said to him, Jesus, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. He said to another man, Jesus said, follow me. But he replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Still another said, Jesus, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Jesus replied, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the service in the kingdom of God. This is God's word. You can be seated, friends. About 4 years ago, I was asked by my brother-in-law, his name is Jamie, he's not here so I can tease him, but I was asked by him to join him, and he also asked another mutual friend of mine to climb Mount Adams in New Hampshire. Now, if any of you know about Mount Adams, it's in the presidential range of the White Mountains. Have you heard of it? It's right near Mount Washington. It's the second highest mountain in the Northeast. The only other higher mountain is Mount Washington, and it's just a few feet lower. It's very comparable to Mount Washington. So if you've ever driven up to the White Mountains, it's so obvious when you approach Washington, just because it towers above all the other mountains. So he asked me to climb it, and at the time, 4 years ago, I was a little bit more pear-like shaped than I am now, and I've been working on that since then, but I was grossly out of shape. And so in all of my just contemplative wisdom, I said, sure, let's do it. I mean, what could go wrong? Round trip, it's about a 10-mile hike to the top and back. And they say a slow pace for people a little bit rotund and out of shape is about a mile an hour, right? Sometimes you're going a little faster, but when you start going up like this, you slow down considerably. But they say plan for about a mile an hour. So 10-mile trip, mile an hour. We got some math geniuses. That's 10 hours, right? Okay. 10-hour trip. I can do this. On the way up, I found myself, you ever see the movie Dumbo? Remember when the train, Casey Jr. is trying to get up the mountain? He's just laboring to get to the top. And I'm like this little train. And just we chugged on for 5 hours. Finally, we summited at the top, taking frequent breaks and eating Snickers bars along the way. We enjoyed the view for a bit. Nice, I made it, still alive. I can still feel my legs. That's good. At least on Mount Washington, by the way, you can take a car or a train down if you just pooped out. Right, but in Mount Adams, no thing. It's not as popular as Washington, so you got to go back the way you came. So we head back down. That's when the fun begins. I'm hopping down from rock to rock like a little billy goat, and about 30 minutes to an hour into this, I feel a sharp sort of twitch in my knee. 30 minutes later, I can barely walk. It was so painful, I could barely walk, and we're still headed down some pretty steep stuff, right? So now I am like limping, kind of on my backside, trying to get down, really going really painfully slow, barely can walk. And then, oh, by the way, you know what happened next? The sun set. And now we're in the dark, okay? So we decide, listen to how brilliant we are. You don't know how brilliant I am and who you hired, but you're about to know. My brother-in-law, the only one fit for this, by the way, he's always been very fit. He played football in high school, does CrossFit, all this nonsense, right? So he's wicked fit. We decide, you know what, we're not going to, you know, we need you to run ahead. This isn't good. Like, we'll be fine. My friend and I, by the way, did I mention he's also equally as out of shape as I am. So we decide that the most fit one should leave us. And you know why? Not to fetch a Mountie. Right, we're not in Canada, wait a minute. Not to fetch a park ranger, that would help, right? Maybe they can rescue us. Maybe they got some kind of helicopter that they can take us the rest of the way. No, we're not sending him to run ahead of us to get help. We're sending him to run ahead of us to get pizza. Good idea. Because it's going to close. We're taking too long, and we really wanted pizza. We were hungry. So we say, Jamie, can you please run ahead? Just, you know, bounce ahead of us really fast. We're right behind you. We'll make it. We'll be okay. So he does it. So there we were, me and my equally pear-shaped friend in the dark. I can barely move, trying to find the trail markers. We lost the trail a couple of times, by the way. Ended up finding it back miraculously. And I don't need to finish the story. Here I am. Nothing too dramatic happened except that it took us a long time to find the car. And you know who was waiting for us when we found it? My friend with pizza. And thank God, right? I was not fit for this climb. I thought I was, but I wasn't. I was foolish in so many ways in this climb. Jesus in verse 62 replied, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God." Friends, as followers of Jesus Christ, we need to be ready. We need to be fit. We have a job to do. And that job is so important. Our life is on the line. Our soul is on the line. Our happiness is on the line. If God has called you to salvation by grace through faith, if he has forgiven you of your sin, he has done this so that you will walk with him. That you will be a fit disciple, and that you'll serve his kingdom. None of us are off the hook. And friends, none of us are ever going to be really, truly happy and live a life of purpose until we fix our eyes to Christ, follow him, and be fit followers of Jesus. It's just the truth. And that's what I want to talk about with you this morning. One of the first people Jesus called to follow him was a Roman tax collector named Levi. Did you know this? We might know him as Matthew. He calls a tax collector. First guy he decides to call. You know that people really loved being overtaxed back then? You like that, right? You love when taxes go up, right? And we love to pay them. It's always such a sweet pill that we get to swallow every March. Oh, and by the way, back then, though, we have a relatively just system, I hope. It seems that way, at least to me. But these tax collectors back then had virtually no accountability at all. They often demanded more taxes than what were even required, and no one could do anything about it. You just had to pay it. So you could just imagine being a Jewish person, a non-Roman. They didn't think much of these guys. And Jesus, by the way, is a non-Roman Jew living amongst non-Roman Jewish people in Israel. They hated these dudes. And Jesus decides to begin his ministry by recruiting a scumbag that nobody liked. That's brilliant, right? You know, that's a good, you know, that's a good VP pick, if you will. I'm going to pick the guy that people like the least, and he's going to be my first man to follow me. Maybe that's why you hired me. I don't know. I'll ask Pete. Matthew does something astounding in Mark chapter 2, verse 14. It simply says, Jesus called him, and he arose and followed him. That's it. Underline, period. Let's move on. He calls Matthew Levi the tax collector, and he arose, quote, and followed him. No explanation. He just left his job that was making him rich to follow a poor Jewish rabbi that nobody knew. That's another great idea. Why on earth would he do? You almost want to like leap into the story and Matthew, you know, this might not be wise. You make a lot of money, you know? There's no psychological or economic or social reasons given. It's almost as if the text implies that Matthew followed Jesus simply because it was Jesus that called him. That there was something just so beautiful, so wonderful about Christ, that he was just worth more than anything that he had done, anything that he had owned. And friends, the same Jesus calls you. The same beautiful Lord, the Savior, the Creator of the earth, calls out to you the same, follow me. And we can do one of two things. We can say, okay, I'm going to put down my money, I'm going to put down my bags of gold, and follow him like Matthew, or we can choose a different path that we'll get to in a moment. As Jesus begins to call more and more people, disciples, to follow him, he begins to teach them what it means. And a handful of people decide they have the nerve to actually do it. And he begins to teach them what it means to actually follow him and be like him. And that's the purpose of the text that we read this morning. It is instruction on not only the cost, but on the life of a Jesus follower. What it means to follow Christ. What it requires. But before we get into that, I'd like to set up a little bit of the context of Luke chapter 9's instruction. Jesus in Luke 9 is giving them instruction on the cost of discipleship. But Luke chapter 9 begins what Bible scholars have called the travel narrative of Jesus. It runs from chapters 9 through 14, and it dominates most of Luke, the Gospel of Luke. All the other sections, Luke is quite long, but all the other sections are just smaller than this section. It is the longest section in Luke, so it's almost as if the author, Luke, is saying, pay attention to this. This is Jesus' journey to Jerusalem. It's his journey to the cross. So in other words, this journey is preparing him for the purpose of his life, and that is death and resurrection, or we could call it promised land. This journey is preparing him to travel to transformation, to travel to the eternal city, to the eternal Jerusalem. So it's his advance to the promised land that is his fate, and this journey is his way there. It's the path to it. So Luke in chapter 9 through 14 is giving us this travel narrative, and it involves all sorts of trouble and all sorts of rejection, and it eventually leads to the death of Christ. Not a very fun journey, but a powerful one if you read it. Because it ends in the glory and resurrection of Christ, the forgiveness of his people. It ends in glory. You know, right before this text where Jesus talks about the cost of discipleship, Jesus is rejected by a host of people in Samaria. And you know what the disciples do? You remember what they ask Jesus? Jesus, they just rejected you, so can we call down fire from heaven and just annihilate all of them? That's maybe what I would have asked. But Jesus says no. He responds emphatically, no, now is the time for preaching mercy so that the lost can be saved, not so that they can be destroyed. Justice is coming, but now is the time to preach the kingdom, to preach Christ, to preach the gospel. And it's at this point he says, let me tell you what my journey is going to be like, because it's going to mirror your journey. It's going to be just like what it means for you to be a Christian and to follow Jesus. So he starts talking to them about how to survive in the desert journey of their lives. The challenge of it, the mission of it. We might think of this theme, by the way, this is a popular theme in the scriptures. We might think of this travel theme in the story of Moses, who is like a type of Jesus. In the story of Israel, who is a type of the disciple or the Christian. You remember that the children of Israel followed Moses through the wilderness. That was their travel narrative. That was their journey. And the question would be simply this. How can a host of people, God's people, travel through a desert, travel through trouble? In other words, travel through something that can't give us life. Deserts can't sustain life. How can the Christian travel through a world that cannot give us life, survive, and make it to the end, to the promised land? How can Christians traversing through trouble, traversing through rejection in a world that sometimes hates us, in a world that can never satisfy us, how can we make it to the end? Jesus says that the path to the promised land, he tells us how, and this is a hard how. We got to be prepared to hear it. Because he says if you want to make it, you have to learn about denial. Self-denial. And I know that sounds awful, an awful lot like drudgery. Self-denial. But if you stay with me, I hope that you'll see by the end of the service that it's not drudgery at all. As a matter of fact, it's the exact opposite. It is thrilling. It is your life. It is pleasure forevermore. So what we deny, we get back. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's go. I don't want to give away the end. So the cost of discipleship and the path of to the promised land demands this sort of denial. First, it demands that we leave our comfort for Jesus. We see that in verse 57. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus replied, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Could you still follow me? You know, it's interesting. Jesus doesn't soften the expectation. He doesn't invite him into the shallow end of the deep pool. This doesn't seem like a seeker-friendly kind of, let's get him in through tricks and treats first, let him stay here for a while, tell him that God will make him rich, and then talk a little bit about sacrifice later. He says right away, listen, I don't have a place to sleep. Do you want that life? So he doesn't soften the expectation. And I know that for many of us, I know for me, oftentimes, my chief end is just to be comfortable in life. I want a nice, soft, comfy bed with a down blanket. I want those sheets to be cool when I climb in, right? Like, I want comfort, man. I want good food, good family, football, vacations. You know, maybe your definition of comfortable is much different than that one. But oftentimes, that's sort of what dominates our thinking. We just want comfort. To have a place in this world. Jesus tells him right away, he says, no. Following me means following me, no matter where I lead you. Following me means following me, not following yourself. He says, even foxes and birds have homes. But this world, in this world, we have no home. We have no home. Christian in Hebrews chapter 11 is stranger and exile, right? So in other words, we're going to go places that we don't want to go. You remember that verse? Peter's talking with Jesus after Jesus died and resurrected. And Jesus tells Peter, do you remember what he says? He's like, Peter, one day someone's going to take you where you don't want to go, the end of your life. And he's referring to Peter's death, gruesome death, crucified upside down, according to church history, alongside all his family, by the way. Imagine the apostle Peter hanging upside down on a cross, aside his wife and children. So you know what Peter says? What about John? He's not ready for this yet. He's like, wait a minute, I don't like this story. What about this guy, you know, the one leaning on your breast? He gets all the favors. What about him? He says, what does it matter if I let him live till I return? He says, you follow me. And by the end of his life, something happened in Peter's journey, in his travel narrative, where he had the courage and faith to hang upside down along his whole wife and family for the cause of Christ, because he loved Christ more, because Christ is better. He's more beautiful. And he did not love his life, even to the end. You see, that was his story. We're stranger in this world, so we go to places often that we don't want to go in life. It doesn't mean that Jesus never provides for us comfort. It doesn't mean for us that we can never watch a movie or sit in a lazy boy or take vacations. It does mean this, though, that we follow him no matter what. It also means this, that he is more comfortable than all those things. He gives us a better comfort that without which all other comfortable things become uncomfortable. You ever sit on a comfortable thing for long enough? Doesn't it become uncomfortable? Your rear end starts to grow numb a little bit. Maybe some of you are experiencing that moment, right? Like, friends, comfortable things become uncomfortable for us, given them long enough. You see, because the comfort we seek can never satisfy fully. Jesus is the comfort. It means that if we do not believe that all the comfort of home and all the rest we need is found in him, if we don't believe that, then we're going to leave him for what becomes uncomfortable. When he becomes uncomfortable, we'll leave him for what we think is more comfortable. This world will become our home, and he will be the stranger. Friends, here's the irony in all this. We will never be comfortable unless we leave our comforts and seek rest in Christ. That's just the truth. If he is not our home, all the other homes will never satisfy us. We'll always want more. We are called to his home. He is not called to ours. Amen? When Israel left slavery in Egypt and entered the wilderness, their constant regret was having left Egypt. Do you remember this? Have you ever read the book of Exodus? They're always complaining about the desert and wishing they were back in Egypt. It says in chapter 16, if only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and all the food we wanted. But you have brought us into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death. Oh, friends, have you ever talked to the Lord like this? God, why have you done this to me? And I know sometimes those questions are real and they're hard and they're not petty either. We lose a child, we lose a husband. Why have you done this to me? And we blame God and wonder if life would have just been better if you never followed him at all. Oh, those moments are so difficult, so challenging. Listen to Moses' words in contrast to Israel's in Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, Moses chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. And though I don't understand, and though it's hard, and though I grieve, I'm not looking back. I'm going to a better home, and I'm going to trust that I'll arrive by the blood of Christ. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value, underline greater value. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as greater value than pots of meat. He is the greater pot of meat. He's the better bread, the better water, the better friend. You see? Friends, when we follow Jesus, all of us leave something behind. We leave behind a pot of meat, as it were. And at times, this loss can be so hard, and it can grieve us. Sometimes our pot of meat that we leave behind is a lifestyle. Sometimes it's friendships. Maybe people that you loved, that you looked down on Christians like us with, that you called friend, that you loved, that you walked alongside and did all sorts of things like school and sports and everything. And now they think you're the crazy one because you left them. They're your pot of meat. You miss them. You miss their flavor, their love. They're your fox's home. They're your bird's nest. And now it's gone. And it causes pain. And that pain, friends, doesn't mean that you've looked back. It doesn't mean that you're not following Jesus, because these things should grieve us. But that grief should remind us of why we turned to begin with. Because we believe that the home we're headed to is better than the home we left. Amen? And we have to hold that in our mind's eye. We have to remember that Christ is glorious and worth it. And I hope that you do this morning. The satisfaction of all those old loves that were given to you in those moments, friends, they were only a dim hint of the love that God has in store for us in Christ. In heaven, where it's a place where God's love reigns supreme, where we will live in inapproachable light. Oh, Lord, haste the day when our faith shall be sight. Amen. And the sky be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound. The Lord shall descend. And I will say, it is well with my soul. So I can leave the pots of meat behind. It's hard, but I can leave and I can trudge on and look forward and trust Christ. The sure way to be robbed of the comfort of home is to stay in yours instead of turning to Jesus's. Friends, Jesus teaches this, but he also teaches that the path to the promised land requires a denial, a second one, and that is that we leave our religion for Jesus. Leave our comforts for Jesus, leave our religion for Jesus. He said to another man, "Follow me," but he replied, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." That's his request. That's his priority there. Before Christ, it's, let me bury my father. There's his priority. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury the dead. You go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Okay, what's going on here? Here Jesus approaches a man. He makes the man an offer. He says, follow me. Follow me. He tells us the same this morning. Follow me. To all of us that have ears to hear, he asks us, follow me. Follow Jesus. Matthew did it without hesitation, but this man hesitates. He's got more important things to do. And it seems here that this man is interested simply and naturally caring for his family. But this task to care for his father, friends, this is more than just caring for family. This task to go home and to be present with his family and care for them is commanded in the law of Moses, the law of God. So this isn't just about devotion to mom and dad. For this man, he was being a good Jew. He was obeying the Ten Commandments. He was following the law of Moses. And friends, it's very interesting here that Jesus says, let the dead bury the dead, you follow me. Is Jesus telling this man to break the law? How do we understand this? Here, the would-be disciple, if you want to follow Jesus, you need to choose. And here's the point that I think that Jesus is making. You need to make a choice. You need to choose to trust in your own rule following for life or to trust in Jesus for life. What forgives your sin? Is it keeping the law or is it the forgiveness of Jesus by grace through faith? See, so what I see in this passage is salvation by grace through faith. This isn't about him telling he can't take care of his dad. It's him about, it's Jesus telling him that taking care of his dad doesn't make him right with him. It doesn't earn him a spot on the team of 12 because he's a good Jew. He's trying to show him that he is not a good Jew, that he is a lawbreaker. And if he's going to follow him, it's not because he deserves it, but because he's being given it by grace through faith. Amen? So to be a disciple of Jesus means that we abandon the idea that we're good enough, that we can make up for the things that we've done that are wrong through clean living. Jesus says that's dead. That's a dead end. Let the dead bury the dead. In other words, let those who are condemned because they think they're good and obedient to the law stay condemned. You follow me. You get life in me. Law following in Scripture produces nothing but condemnation. We are judged by it because we're all guilty of breaking it. We are always condemned by it. That's the message of Romans. That's the message of Galatians. The whole Bible, the law in Galatians is a tutor or a schoolmaster meant to teach us that we are guilty and unable to keep the law. I heard one pastor say that we can't even keep our own rules, let alone God's. Right? Imagine, what would your Ten Commandments be? I am the Lord your God. Success. Work success. I am the Lord your God who will make you successful and competent that everyone wants to be like you. You shall not wake up late. You shall be in work early. You shall work harder than every other person around you. You shall save your money and not spend frivolously. Man, I tripped over that word. There's your Ten Commandments. What are they? I'm going to be a good daughter. I'm going to get win the love of a boy. That is the Lord my God. That's what gives me meaning. That's what gives me purpose. So what are my Ten Commandments? I'm going to always have lipstick on. I'm going to always look good. My clothes are going to accentuate the things that I think. I'm always going to be put together because I want someone to look to me and be admire by my beauty. See? So what are your Ten Commandments? If it's success, then you're going to have a lot of different rules. If success is the Lord your God, then you're going to have a lot of different rules in your life to help you gain that success. And friends, how are you doing, by the way, with that? How's that God treating you? Are you able to keep all the rules? Have you never woken up late? Have you never screwed up in work? Right? Maybe someone works a little harder than you. If you were to stand before you when you die on the basis of your own rules, would you be innocent or guilty? Be guilty 100 times over. I can't even keep my rules, let alone God's rules. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Let the dead bury the dead and come and drink of the waters of life for free without cost. You see, friends, if we're ever going to be a disciple of Jesus that makes it and continues, we have to believe that we don't deserve to be there. But God has, but Jesus has allowed us by grace to be there and forgiven us. It's the only way we'll make it. Otherwise, every challenge in the Christian life you'll think is your fault and then you'll want to quit. And every victory in your life you'll get credit for and say, look at what I've done. You see, you have to stop being the fire cloud and let God be the fire cloud. Let me explain to you what I mean. You remember Jesus. Remember the children of Israel were led through the desert by the fire cloud. That fire cloud opened the Red Sea. It gave them water from rocks. It gave them bread from heaven. It was God himself. You see, the fire cloud provided them the means of life. So are you the fire cloud or is God? You see, friends, if you're ever going to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, if you're ever going to make it to the end, you have to deny yourself. You have to stop thinking that you're the one that earns your spot, but accept the love and grace of Christ. Here, the irony is that in our efforts to keep the law, we are condemned by the law. So Jesus calls a tax-collecting scumbag to join his inner circle because Matthew knew he was a scumbag. If you're going to follow Jesus, if you are to be fit for service, you need to leave your religion And you need to accept and trust in the free grace of Jesus Christ. Amen. In place of rule following, Jesus commands, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. That is, go and proclaim that it is God that rules in this world, not you. And if we are ever to live in his presence, it's going to be by his grace, by the Lamb who died. Finally, let's close with this. Jesus teaches that the path to the promised land requires denial and demands we leave our family. This one's strange. This is our last point. And I want to encourage you with this because this isn't what it sounds like. Let's read. Still another said in verse 61, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Jesus replied, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. It's just like Jesus, you know, take it easy. We kind of feel like that a little bit when we read this, right? Even Elijah let Elisha go kiss his mom. Remember that in the Old Testament? He's about to follow Elijah, and he says, can I go kiss my mom? And he says, sure. You know, don't be long, though. Right? But Jesus is not Elijah. Something greater than Elijah, something more important is happening here with Christ. The call to leave your family, it just seems unreasonable. It seems provocative. And I think it was even more so then. Everything was connected to family back then in ways that they aren't anymore. Saying goodbye, burying fathers, it just seems like the right, decent thing to do, to allow someone to do these things. Jesus says, no, you are not fit to be a servant of the kingdom if you do this. What's the problem here? And the problem is this, it's very simple. No one can follow two things at once. You are either following mom and dad, or wife, or children, or work, or you're following Christ. You got to choose. See, Jesus is not an addendum. He's not like something that we keep in the house for when we need, when it becomes useful to us in our lives, to get us out of a mess that we've made or to fix some problem that we're in. So we pull him out when we need him. Like a screwdriver from a junk drawer, right? Jesus said, you got to choose. Am I your master and Lord, or is it something else? No one can serve two things at once. If you try, you will eventually pick one over the other. Jesus must be our true north. He must be where we are headed, our compass, or we'll set him aside for any convenience or affection that competes with him. In the earliest part of the Bible, if you recall, in the book of Genesis, in the creation story, when God's creating the world, we see right away that our devotion to mom and dad at some point ends. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, it says, a man shall leave his father and mother and cling to his wife. In other words, he has a new primary devotion, and it's not mom and dad anymore. It's husband or wife. So that new family structure decides where you live and work and what church you go to, not mom and dad. Also in Genesis chapter 2, God tells the offspring, the fruit of Adam and Eve, go and fill the earth and subdue it. That's sort of like the mission. In other words, at some point, your kids are going to have to leave you. And it's built into the fabric of our bones. This is before sin. This is not a curse. This is who we are, as God, our identities, if you will, as God made us. So in marriage, it means that we're chiefly devoted to our wives. In the kingdom, or husbands, in the kingdom, it means that we are chiefly devoted to Jesus above every other earthly relationship. Jesus is not saying that we do not care for, consider, or respect those that we love, our family or friends even. We are not abandoning them in that sense. We're not abandoning even our service to them, but we are adjusting our priority to them. They don't call the shots, in other words. Our Heavenly Father does. You might start following Jesus and long for your old life, as I said before. Those pots of meat. So you start to plow your field. I'm headed towards Jesus, but you remember it and you want to look back. You ever try to mow a lawn and not keep your eyes on the lawn? You start doing this. You ever drive and text? Don't. you start swerving, it ends bad. When you have two masters and you look away from the master, it ends bad. That's what Jesus is saying. Rather than looking to where we're headed, we start to look back. The field never gets plowed and we become unfit workers. Friends, it doesn't mean that we never fail. Because Peter failed, we know that. And Jesus restored him. But what Jesus is teaching us here is that following him is not one more obligation in life added to many other obligations. Following him is our chief priority. And we do whatever he says to do. And here is the irony, that in our efforts to know the love of dad and mom, we never know the love of the better dad. If you want to follow dad, follow Jesus. So let me close with a few more words. Friends, I want to encourage you. The reason that this is hard is because it's good. When we truly trust in Christ as the better dad, the better home, the better comfort, the better life, the denial that we go through and experience in life is sweetened by the honey of Christ. You see, it ends up not being a sacrifice at all, because everything we lost, we get back in him. Everything that we were after and all those other pursuits in life that we put down to follow him, he gives us all those things back in him and satisfies us even more. He's the pearl of great price. He's the treasure hidden in the field. Come and get him. Follow Christ. The cost of following Jesus is better than the things that we lose in our following of him. So Jesus isn't telling us to diss our parents, to leave our wives, and that we can't have money or take vacations. He's saying that our hearts shouldn't be commanded by these things, that those things are his, and if he tells us to put them down or give them away, that we need to. He's saying simply to do this, not only just for the sake of the end of just being a sacrificial person, but because he knows that when our hearts aren't married to those things, our hearts are truly free. They're satisfied in a way that they never were before. He's trying to show us the way to life. To be a disciple is to have a heart that is married to Jesus Christ and nothing else. When I married my wife, I said, I do. And she said, I do to me, I think. I checked the tape and I can confirm it. But you know, when I said I do to her, I said I don't to every other girl in the room. So there was a negative implied. I do to you and I don't to everything else. Friends, when you say I do to Christ, he becomes your treasure. And everything else serves to sort of complement that new relationship. Encourage it. Isn't that true in marriage? That friendships around you, it's not that you can't have them or you can't love people, but they can actually be instruments to help you love your spouse even more. Oh, friend. Have a heart wed to Jesus. Marry him and don't marry everything else around you. This unashamed and dogged running alongside the master is better. The Christian knows it and by it is made fit. Friends, Christ is the better rest who is preparing a better place. He is the one that the only one that kept the law so that we could be saved by grace and keep the better law of love. Friends, he is the greater parent that loves you more than mom and dad ever did. And when we devote our devotion to these things and we sacrifice them, we get them all back. And perhaps in an unexpected form, not in a couch or a new relationship or a house, but in the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Come and get them. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, how we love you this morning. How we give you great praise and great thanks for all that you've done for us. God, if there's anyone here this morning that does not know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, this all sounds kind of maybe confusing or difficult for them. Friend, Jesus loves you. Jesus is God in the flesh. He became a man. He was God, created all things. He became a man so that he could die in your place. The wages of sin is death. Sin has separated you from God, friend. and you can be reconciled to that relationship again with your Maker and find yourself for the first time fully forgiven and know who you really are by being reconciled to God through Jesus. Trust Him. Cry. The Bible says, call on the name of the Lord and you'll be saved. So friend, if you're hearing this and you don't know Jesus Christ, call out to God in the silence of your own heart, God, I'm a sinner, save me. Jesus is my Savior. I need that better home. I need forgiveness. I need rest. I need that better relationship that all the other ones could never satisfy me, and I need you. Be my fiery cloud. Friend, trust in the death and resurrection from Christ, and all the deaths of your life will be made alive. I hope that you will, and I hope that you'll share that with me if you have new faith. And God, for the rest of us, I pray, Lord, that you would teach us to trust you, to put our hands to the plow and to not look back. And when we grieve about those lost pots of meat, help us to remember the better meal that you're preparing for us in your eternal city. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Kyle. Will you please stand out as we sing our closing song, How Great Is Our God.
Sing with me, how great. soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Lord God, you are the name above all names. Your name is above depression. Your name is above loneliness. Your name is above anxiety. Your name is above cancer. Your name is above all other names. We praise you, Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, and grant you peace. Amen. You're dismissed.
These chains will never break.